To accept the deal, broken by the White House, or if they're closer to a strike. These unions represent engineers and conductors, and if those agreements aren't ratified, they'll head back to the bargaining table for a revised December deadline. Experts say the U.S. economy could lose $2 billion a day if those railroad workers go on strike.
Let's stay on all things supply chain here. Let's bring in John Gold, the National Retail Federation's Vice President for Supply Chain and Customs. And John, you just heard Danny mention the potential railroad strike. How debilitating would this be for the retail shopping season? But look, even the economy will grow.
But I think a rail strike could cause $2 billion in damage a day to the U.S. economy. That's what the American Association of Railroads has projected. It's significant. Everybody relies on the rails to get their goods to market. Imports, exports, agriculture, manufacturers waiting on production, also sensitive materials, things like chlorine to get healthy drinking water. So this is significant if a rail strike were to occur on December 9th.
Right, speaking on labor, automation has been tossed around a lot in the conversation. Is that the future of supply chain? Seeing on the port side, also anything revolving around supply chain.
Certainly are critical to the future of the supply chain. If you truly want to have a 21st century global supply chain, you've got to bring technology and automation into it. You've got to bring the workers into it as well. They've got to be part of the discussion as we're talking about the future of technology and automation. They've got to be part of that conversation. But it is going to be significant. We've got to move forward on getting that as a part of the supply chain. We've got to have better visibility, better connectivity for all the partners to understand what's happening at any stage of the supply chain.
For those that don't have your expertise, John, would a railroad strike, does that mean the truckers, logistics companies, how can they pick up the slack? Would they just be overrun with demand and orders?
So if a rail strike were to happen, that means the entire freight rail system would shut down. That means products moving from the ports, moving from the country, export tuning out. There is some capacity to pick up in truck, but they're not going to pick up all the carbon that moves on truck. On rail, it goes on to truck, so we're going to have capacity issues.
Well, sounds like major delays.
Definitely products. Major delays if it were to happen. Obviously, a short-term would be better, but we hope there's no disruption whatsoever.
And speaking of trucking, California has this ambitious plan to make their trucking fleets, change from diesel to electric. How feasible is that really for our current environment, our supply chain?
Because the truckers have sent California, it's a challenge. You don't have the infrastructure in place to be able to do the charging for the trucks that are made, especially in our ports. We've got a clean truck program that are going to affect the ports in Long Beach. We don't have the number of trucks, we don't have the infrastructure. So I think many shippers want to work with the California legislature. Let's get to the inner economy. Let's do their right thing. We don't force people out of business to make it happen.
In the supply chain, based on what you're seeing, based on what you're hearing from your contacts, what does the inflationary outlook look like over the next 6 months?
I think inflation continues to be a concern. Housing consumers continue to be concerned about that, but look, we're going to have a positive holiday season. What we've seen thus far, the research we've done, we're looking at 6-8% growth in the holiday season this year. So looking at $960 million in spending by consumers. So I think there's a lot of unknowns what happens going into next year. I think retailers are trying to plan their best to be ready for that continuing consumer demand that we've seen for the past 30 months.
Speaking of that, things have really shifted on the West Coast. They've gone from choke to fluid now, but there's also a dilemma, and that is on the warehousing capacity. What is the solution there? I've heard that warehouses are now expanding their outdoor space, but how much of that is really a temporary solution?
Yeah, I think a lot of the challenge we face on the West Coast was only bringing the product in earlier in the season, but also we've got the ongoing labor negotiations on the West Coast. That's why you saw such a shift this summer to the East Coast. We've got East Coast and Gulf Coast ports are full. right size our inventory, we're going to be better able to process that inventory moving forward. But, you know, making sure we're able to open up new warehouses, have better fulfillment centers and things, have regulations to help incentivize opening new warehouses, move warehouses, you know, to other locations, have inland locations, and shift cargo to there. So I think there are some options there, but we've all got to work together to get to that.
Is the labor shortage in the trucking industry still as severe as it was a year ago?
From what we hear, there still is a significant driver shortage that we do face, both on the drayage side as well as the long haul side. So I think labor throughout the supply chain continues to be a challenge.
Yeah, and I wanted to shift gears a little bit on the U.S.-China trade dispute saga. Do you believe that tariffs are inflationary, and is it really worth it given our inflationary environment right now?
We said from the outset that tariffs were not the right strategy to deal with China trade issues. Putting tariffs on products for everyday consumers doesn't make sense. It has not worked. We haven't seen China make the changes they were supposed to because of the tariffs. So we think there are better opportunities to engage China on some of these trade factors. I know it impacted the U.S., but it impacted our trade
partners
as well. I think through ongoing dialogue, I think, look, having President Biden to, I think she actually have a conversation. Once again, get that dialogue going. And then let's figure out a better path forward, because the tariffs that are applied on the Chinese imports impact U.S. consumers, impact China, U.S. manufacturers, really raises the cost of these goods for the American consumer. Not right now, but we want to continue to change. You know, now with USTR having their 4-year review of the tariffs, we know that we have an opportunity to talk about the negative impact the tariffs have had over the past 4+ years. And then again, open the door to have this conversation with China, which we haven't had in almost 2 years.
I'm asking every guest that we have on here their big prediction for this holiday season. Are empty shelves open? What is your big prediction?
I think, look, our big prediction, we put our forecast out a couple weeks ago. We're looking at 6-8% growth over last year's holiday sales, roughly $942 to $960 billion in consumer spending this year.
That's not recessionary.
I think, look, consumers have continued to spend throughout the pandemic and then some. We've seen 30+ months of month-on-month growth in the retail sector. Consumers want to go out and continue to spend and celebrate the holidays. We haven't been able to do it in the past. So again, we're looking for another positive holiday season. We're looking at, you know, 166 million consumers with engaged in this 5-day holiday weekend. We're talking about either in store or online. So consumers ready to go out
there. No, I'm ready to engage, my man. I'm going to go out there and buy myself something. I don't know what it is, but you know what? I'm going to find it. John Gold, National Retail Federation Vice President for Supply Chain and Customs. Good to see you.
Yeah, really good.
Good to see you. Appreciate it.